I didn't want to take pills anymore. In fact, I don't think it was that long. I think it might have actually been fairly rapidly. I think 2 or 3 months, I'd actually stopped drinking as well at that point. That's probably what was in my mind. I'd started weightlifting to develop the muscles in my back, and I started taking to that like a duck to water, and I just fell in love with weightlifting and with bodybuilding. I didn't want to take pills anymore. In fact, I don't think it was that long. I think it might have actually been fairly rapidly. I think 2 or 3 months, I'd actually stopped drinking as well at that point. That's probably what was in my mind. I'd started weightlifting to develop the muscles in my back, and I started taking to that like a duck to water, and I just fell in love with weightlifting and with bodybuilding. That became my new addiction. I mean, you ask the people that were around me at that time, I was weightlifting 3 times a day, 7 days a week. And I know people say, what? True. God's honest truth, let your yeses be yes and your noes be noes, and when you speak, let it be in truth and be genuine. That is genuine truth. I was training 3 times a day, 7 days a week, and you know that there was no signs of me stopping. I rapidly fell in love with bodybuilding, as I say. And it's interesting that this year is 2012 when we're recording this, the year of the Olympics in London. I was actually training for the Olympics, and how all that came about was, I think I'd been chatting with my dad and he was saying, you know, you're getting pretty strong. You know, you could, you know, train to be like an Olympic athlete or whatever. And I started training for that and what have you. Unbeknownst to me, these guys are lifting like, you know, 400 or 500 pounds, you know. And at that point, I was probably deadlifting maybe 130, 140, which for a 13, 14-year-old kid is pretty impressive, you know, as it is. You know, I mean, that's, you know, like the weight of a woman, for example, and some guys. You know, so I mean, that was a cool time. My dad worked with a guy who was, he trained in bodybuilding and he'd done all this stuff, and he agreed to take me under his wing. And Craig, his name was, came to me one night and he was just like, look, kid, you know, you're training more like a powerlifter or a bodybuilder than you are as an Olympic athlete. You know, you've just not got the weight on you. And as you can see, I am not naturally a massive guy. Everything that I've got bodybuilding wise has all been natural. And the motto I used to use when I was training and even training kids was, if you can't get it naturally, don't get it at all. I was absolutely 100% anti-steroids. I don't like them. I think they're a shortcut. I'm not a big fan of them at all. And I think it is a poison that unfortunately infiltrated bodybuilding and it gives it a negative vibe. I think that's a massive, massive thing. That's just my opinion, you know, for what it's worth. So as time went on, I started thinking, oh, bodybuilding, you know, that's interesting. Got involved with bodybuilding, made a few inquiries, and before I knew it, I was now training for events and for shows. I mean, that in itself was really, really cool to be going to work and saying, I need this day off. Why? Well, I've got a bodybuilding show and, you know, the next day I'm going to be wiped out. To be noticed around people in the town, I mean, pretty much everyone locally in Huddersfield Town knew me, you know, and knew me for bodybuilding. You know, I'd go into shops and there was people there that was promoting me. There was companies, Active Sports being one of them, that were like, yeah, you know, we'd totally like to do this with you. I was the hometown boy. I was the hometown hero. You know, there's no doubt about that. I would walk through the bus station and people would look at you after you've been in the gym and it's like, wow, you know, that air of confidence that's there. And yes, well, I had Christ in my life and Christ was, you know, working all these things out and God's there and the Spirit's at work. It takes time. It's not just a quick fix. It's a long process. And as I say, I mean, I was, you know, living it. I was, you know, living the dream, as it were, for, you know, I think at that point I was probably 17, 18 by the time I started bodybuilding in terms of really looking to compete. I was 18 when I did my first show in the Home Firth Civic Centre. And, you know, as I say, that for an 18-year-old guy, that was really, really cool. I'm not kidding. That was amazingly cool. But unfortunately, sometimes things don't go as we plan them. And I developed colitis, which, for those of you who don't know, is basically like it's like a disease that it eats away at your stomach lining. And I was bleeding heavily, and I remember people around me at that time saying, seriously, you need to stop this. Me being my arrogant self, I didn't listen. And at that point, I was just like, I don't want to stop. So I continued bodybuilding. All the way through this time, there's two big things going on. I was bodybuilding, but the spiritual changes that was happening in my life, was really taking a big turn. And I went back to the Catholic Church. I think I was about 18 at the point I went back to the Catholic Church. Well, in the August of that year, I can't remember, that might have been in 2007 maybe. I can't actually remember. But I do remember the priest coming out and saying, yep, because we're not getting enough members of the church, we're closing down, which they did. And at that point, my gran was like, yeah, we need to go to this other church in town. And I was like, I really don't want to. And I felt that I wanted to go to this little Baptist church right across from my grandma's. Now, my grandma's Catholic, and I was going to a Baptist church. Big friction. Massive friction. When I was baptized, my grandma really struggled with that because she didn't understand it. And my family really struggled with that because they didn't understand it. Having said that, now they look back and they're like, wow, you can see God so much at work in all of this and in my life. And I remember my mum coming to me and saying, you don't talk about it, we don't want to set any waves off or anything. I just said, Mum, I can't not talk about it. There's amazing things going on in my life. I'm free of addiction. I need to talk about this stuff, about what Jesus Christ is doing in my life. And not in a way that it's religious or cheesy, but I just need to be honest. This is where I was. This is where I'm going. So I went to the Baptist church, and there I knew there was something very different that went on. As I say, I mean, the development that went on in my life, the people that I got to meet, and the genuine friends, and that was the first time that I ever really felt accepted and part of the family, and really into that, outside of my own family, if that makes sense. So I mean, that was a massive, amazing thing, and the Baptist church there is one that I will always hold in fond memory. Special to me. I think, as everyone knows now, I've gotten to meet some of the most amazing people from all over the world, through artwork, through Facebook and social media, and God willing, in the future I'll get to travel and meet them all in person, and actually exhibit and do the live workshops as well, because it's wonderful, yes, when you make a sale, but truth be told, it's actually meeting the people, and actually the people matter more to me than actually making that happy book. Money, I'd be a very miserable person. And I think, as you can tell, listening to this and watching this, I'm a very happy person. because of the people that I meet, the stuff that they share with me, the conversations that we have, sometimes 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, and sometimes even later. But we have a blast. We do. And I am so thankful for the amazing people that I've been so privileged to meet. So what happens now? You know, now I've been free from addiction. I've met Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ has come into my life. He's my Lord. He's my Saviour. God is working away and the Holy Spirit is you know, leading me and guiding me. I'm a youth worker for the Church of Scotland. But I will go wherever God calls me. Make no mistake about that. I am not denominational in the slightest. I'm probably denominational about being non-denominational, if that makes sense. Professional artist, literally, that's gone in a very different stream, that's not just exhibiting his work, but actually is doing it a lot through social media. That's interesting. I'm a student of theology. I've been blessed. That there's something, that this is the amazing part. Because as they say, behind every good man is a good woman. And my dear, dear fiance, Zoe, is that good woman. I am one very much who will run with an idea and keep running and keep working and working and working, probably until I work myself into the ground. And Zoe is actually one that will come to me and say, John, you need a rest. You need to stop. She's one that will look at a painting and say, I think this needs changing, like your perspective or shadows here or just something, that third, you know, almost like a third person, just to come and look and say, you need that. You know, you need to change that. And as I say, the Lord really, really did bless me with her, because I just to tell you the quick story about how we met. I was helping a friend move flat, and he'd already asked someone else to help him. The guy literally just said no, you know, whatever. And my friend came and asked me. Zoe was there on the lawn. I'm there taking boxes in and out. Zoe's there on the lawn. Our first conversation, we got talking about giraffes and what noise they make, if they make a noise at all, and banana boxes. That's how we started out. And before we knew it, you know, we were together, and, you know, nearly 2 years on, you know, it's something that's very special. I know people look at, oh, it's only been 2 years, you know, you won't be saying that in 20 years. I hope and pray I am. And I hope and pray that you're wrong. Because as far as I'm concerned, I want our marriage and our life, when we do get married, God willing, to be filled with the joy of the Lord. Not to be filled with arguments and all the other crap that goes along with it. So that's my personal plea, you know, and I'm sticking to it. But from all of this, you know, I'm having a blast getting to do all the things that I get to do now. And as I say, getting to preach or to teach how Christianity applies and the stuff that's happening today to youth is amazing. To me, it's the biggest gift and the biggest calling that you can be called to. You can be called to and be a minister. I'm not knocking this at all. But I think when you're called to be a youth worker, you're dealing with the church of tomorrow.